Good morning, everyone. If you guys want to stand with us, let's start worship. One, two.
You may be seated. Good morning, everybody. Happy New Year and welcome to winter in Nebraska. If you're visiting today, of course, we want to welcome you. Any details for announcements that you need or you would like, you can get at the information table in the back. We also have our website, gbcbellevue.org, that you can visit to find out more details. Junior high and senior high youth groups, Quench and Lifeline, meet Sundays after church for food and fellowship, including today. We'll not be meeting next week. We have a special meeting coming up. There will be a future goals and finance meeting, as well as a thank you to all of our volunteers luncheon. That will be held after our church service next week. So we hope that you'll plan on attending that. We do need your RSVPs today if you're planning to attend. For food planning. And then if you would please sign up at the information table and see Kathy Renikoff. If you'd like to help with that, we can sure use help with that. So it's next Sunday after the church service, a special luncheon. We're going to be talking about our church's future, do some planning, and tell you some of our vision. So we hope that you'll plan on coming to that. Now, in the back, by a table back there, there are, and I'm going to read this. I have no idea what I'm talking about. Maybe you've thought that while I'm preaching too, but it says that we have, there are fleece and patterns that are in the back if you want to do prep work before next Saturday. Seams for a Cause is meeting. It's Seams for a Cause and Crafty Ladies Group. And they're going to be meeting next Saturday, 10 to 4. Do I have that right? 10:30 to 4. Okay. 10:30 to 4. You can come for all of it or part-time. And there's going to be a, we'll meet the same place where the cookie and ornament exchange was held. So please RSVP for that as well. Any details that I may not have gotten right or you'd like to have, you can check at the information table. There'll be a table in the back as well. Birthdays. Kyle Lorenz on the 4th has a birthday. Happy birthday to Kyle. And on the 5th, Julia Anna Hendrickson and Dave Haugie share a birthday. So happy birthday to both of you. And then anniversaries on the 6th, Dave and Rosemary Haugie will be married 49 years. Everybody sounds amazed at Rosemary's endurance. And then Jason and Susan Plummer on the 8th, 28 years. Happy anniversary to all of them. Oh, looks like I missed some birthdays space. Back to birthdays, just because we like to change things up a little bit. On the 7th, Ruth Hampson, Nathan Haugie, and Dan Musselman all have a birthday. Wow. And then Debbie Peterson has a birthday on the 8th of January. And on the same day, Penelope Plummer is planning on celebrating her second birthday on the 8th. Happy birthday to all of you. As you know, we don't take up a formal offering. We do have a box in the back that you can contribute to. And if you'd like to, there are regular ways to contribute, obviously through regular deductions in your accounts and then also Venmo. So we'd like to thank you for your support that way. We're going to be dismissing children to their classroom in just a minute as we take the bread. Before we do that, we want to just remember our good friend Rick Peterson. Rick will have a funeral coming up shortly. We're not one. Here's a picture of he and Debbie at their baptism. And we want to, of course, express our condolences to Debbie over the loss of the family and friends. And we don't know all the details of funeral coming up yet, but please keep an eye on your email so that you can keep up with all the information on that. So as we take the bread today, a couple things we're going to be praying for Rick. But we also want to tell you that if you're a visitor here, if you don't know, you have eternal life. This is a great time for us because we like to remember each week that Jesus Christ paid for all of our sins. And because of that, amazingly, he can offer us the free gift of everlasting life. Love to talk to you more about that if you're interested. For a believer, this is a great time to just settle your heart before God and to make sure that your heart is right. So many distractions happen every day that our hearts can be pulled away from our focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you would, let's take about a minute of prayer and let's go before the Lord to make sure we're ready to worship. Father, I want to thank you for this day. Thank you for restraining the weather that we might be able to meet today. And as we think about Rick Peterson, I think about the fact that he's by your side even as we pray, very much whole and healthy. We pray for Debbie that you'd give her grace and comfort. And I remember our lunch togethers we talked about when they believed in Christ for everlasting life. As we take this bread, we want to take it with gratitude, Lord Jesus, because of the great work that was done on the cross, completely adequate for everything we've ever done wrong, to make us one body in him. So thank you for this bread. In Christ's name, amen. Thank you, Allie. I had planned on beginning right around this time our study together in the book of 1 Samuel. But after my message last week, I had some people ask if I would do a study on prayer. I don't know if I've ever done an extended one, but the more I meditated on it this week and had prepared my other message, at least in part, I thought, you know, this might be a good idea. I don't claim to be an expert. I never would claim that. It's one thing to talk about a study from an intellectual standpoint. It's another thing to present something that is supposed to be done from a practical standpoint. So all I want to do is to share some of the things I've learned. This is far from comprehensive, but it is to hopefully motivate you in your own lives to spend some time in prayer. I think that prayer kind of intimidates a lot of us. We're not exactly sure how to do it. So today, I only wanted to cover two things on prayer, hopefully. Talk about different aspects of prayer, some elements of them, and then I want to talk about preparations for prayer. Now, next week, my goal is to launch into several examples from the Bible as to how we might pray and what we might pray for. It is, for me, an ongoing process. But today I wanted to start with one main idea, and that is God is approachable. Prayer really does matter, and God is approachable. So let's talk a little bit about this. On your handouts, we don't have PowerPoints today on purpose because there's so many things we're covering. I think the PowerPoints would probably eat up all the computer space. Paul talked about daily regular prayer. One aspect of prayer is that there are things you should pray for all the time. I want you to think about this because we're going to talk about this week and next week. What would it mean to you if you knew that God would grant you some desires of your heart? For example, does it matter to you that your children are spiritual? Does it matter to you that your mother and father are spiritual? How about your siblings? How about your friends? Does the salvation of those individuals matter to you? Does it matter to you if your friends go to hell or to heaven? Does it matter to you, for example, that your family may have health and safety? Does it matter to you that the country is a country where the culture is a open, positive culture toward the Lord Jesus Christ? Does Satan's influence in your life and in the lives of those you love matter to you? Do those things matter to you? That's just a few examples of what we're going to be talking about over the course of this study. Well, if it matters to you, and if you believe God responds to it, that's a big if. You should be praying. For a lot of us, we don't feel prayer matters. For a lot of us, and we may not say this out loud, but for a lot of us, what we really do think is, it's not going to matter if I pray. God's going to do what God's going to do. That's a very unfortunate consequence of an understanding, or maybe I should say a misunderstanding, of the sovereignty of God. So let's look a little bit more deeply into this. And when we talk about this daily prayer, Paul says in Philippians 1:3, I thank my God upon my every remembrance of you, always offering prayer for you. So Paul would pray on a regular basis. In 2 Timothy 1, he says to Timothy that he prays for him. 1:3, I thank my God whom I serve with a pure conscience as my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers night and day. Night and day. And so on a regular basis, Paul prayed for Timothy. One of the reasons was he was a disciple and he wanted Timothy to be faithful. But if you notice here, Paul talked about praying in the morning and the evening. Now, Daniel, how many know how many times a day Daniel talks about praying? Right, it's three times a day. And he was pretty open about the fact that he was praying because when they told him to stop, he just did what he did all the time and opened his window and said, I'm not going to stop. So is regular prayer. Why is that important? For a lot of us, we don't have a regular prayer time. And with that lack of a regular prayer time, the problem is it comes to your mind, you pray. Well, it might be, for example, that you want your children to marry a good spiritual spouse. If you don't, believe me, to quote Yoda, you will. Oh, you will. It's important because that matters to your family's lives. And so you should be praying about that on a regular basis. You should be praying about health. You should be praying about safety, things like that. And so if you don't have that regular time of prayer, there are going to be things you're not going to think about. And I would advise you when you do that to have organized, I like to do it on a piece of paper, what it is and who it is you want to pray for. For example, if you're younger, someday you plan on being married, or if you're older and someday you plan on being married, you should be praying for your spouse. I remember Cheryl told me that when she was in junior high school, her Sunday school teacher said, you ladies should be praying for your spouse. Cheryl started praying for her future spouse. Right about that time, my mother died and I became a Christian. And I thank the Lord that she was praying for me before we even knew one another. So those are the kinds of things you should occupy yourself with on regular prayer. We're going to talk about more details next week. But there are also what I call popcorn prayers. A lot of you are familiar with that expression. And those are specific situations that come up in the course of life. Paul talks about how when he was in prison, he says that he wanted to stand unashamed before God. And he says, I know this will turn out for my deliverance, my salvation, through your prayers and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. So our prayers make a difference. There are specifics in life that come up through the course of the day. Somebody will say to you, pray for me. You ever had this happen? You have anybody say to you, hey, would you pray about this? You say, sure. And then a week later they say, hey, thanks for praying. And inside you're going, I am so wretched. I never did pray. A lot of times it's a good habit right when they ask you to pray about something or to write it down and let them know that your prayers are important to me. So there are many examples in the Bible. I'll give you one. Probably you've just read it recently. It's from the book of Philemon, and you go, yeah, I know that one. Philemon, verse 22, I'll read you this one. It says, but meanwhile, also prepare a guest room for me. He tells, is it Onesimus or Philemon? Yeah, he writes to Philemon. That's why the book's called that. For I trust that through your prayers I shall be granted to you. So he counted on the fact that Philemon was praying that he would be delivered. James 5:13, is anyone among you suffering? What are you supposed to do? You're supposed to pray. See, so as these situations come up, Lord, I pray that the interview for the job will go well. I pray that the appointment at the doctor would go well, those popcorn prayers. And then there's times of praise. And this is an area of my life that I'm really starting to focus on because praise is not something that I find as part of a lot of people's lives, thanking God for things. We pray about things. We oftentimes don't thank the Lord for them. But the Bible says, remember, he says, oh, praise the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together, Psalm 34. In Psalm 103, he talks about blessing the Lord and forget not all who his benefits. He heals all your diseases and so on. He goes down a list of things God does. And when the Bible says, bless the Lord, O my soul, let all that is within me bless his holy name. Bless in the original language means to enlarge or to make great. And what you're doing when you're blessing God and praising him is in your mind and in the minds of other people, you're pushing the sides out. You're making God great because oftentimes our faith is tied directly to the size of the object. And it's been said before, you don't necessarily need a great faith, but you do need faith in a great God. Jesus said you could have faith of a mustard seed and do great things. But it's important that the God you're praying to is large, because when we think it doesn't matter, or we think he can't handle it, or we're living in stress, it's because, as J.B. Phillips said in the title of one of his books, your God is too small. And so blessing the Lord, praising him is right to thank him for things, but blessing him means to make him great, like I said, to enlarge him. That's what you want to do in the minds of your children, in the minds of your family, all your loved ones. You want God made great in their eyes. And so I've realized at times that with Cheryl at times, if I'm concerned about something, I'm making God smaller in her mind. And one of my goals is to say, the Lord's going to handle this and to to lead a life of faith that encourages those around me. Well, let's move on from aspects of prayer to preparations for prayer. And this is a little bit long, but I'm hoping that it's helpful. We'll go through some of it quickly, but some of it we really want to camp on. Do you know that when Jesus prayed in Luke 11:1, the disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray." And I read one guy, I loved it. He said, that's one of the greatest prayers anybody can pray. You ever asked that? You ever said to God, "Would you teach me how to pray? I don't have a clue. I want to learn more about this." Jesus said, "Come unto me, all who are weary and heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Become a disciple of Jesus. Teach me." And there's many nights that I'll say to the Lord, "Lord, I'm struggling with this. I'm struggling with anger. I'm struggling with fear. I'm struggling with this. Teach me how to live through this." And he does. And so we go to the Lord. We ask him to teach us how to pray. Colossians 4:2 says to devote yourselves to prayer. And in the original language, the word devote is a strong word. It's a command. Devote your, be passionate about prayer. Sometimes our prayers to God say more about us than they do about him. You know, we sit down and we go through these routines with no passion, and we don't understand why people aren't passionate about God. You know, rub-a-dub-dub, thanks for the grub, yay God, amen. You know, that's our prayer at the mealtime. We pray to God as though he's not a living, powerful king of the universe. It's insulting. And the Bible, when it says, talks about praying, it says that Elijah prayed with prayer, and in the original language, it means he had a passionate prayer. For 3.5 years, he prayed for 3.5 years, it didn't rain. Then he prayed again and it rained. He prayed with passion. And the Bible says he bent down, put his head between his knees, was passionate about prayer. Shouldn't we be passionate about prayer if there's a God on the other end of those requests? He's the great God of the universe. Let's act like it. We say, "Gee, I don't understand why my kids aren't excited." Are you excited about prayer? Dependence. Now, I want to talk to you about this one. This is a concern of mine. Jesus talked about not using empty, repetitious prayers. And there are groups that will do that. He says the concern is they think they will be heard for their many words. If we just keep repeating the same words over and over again, that moves God. Our God's not a robot. He's a personal God. And just repeating the same prayers isn't going to get it done. Jesus says in Matthew 6 in that same place, he says, he already knows what you need. Men and women, we are not praying to inform God. "Lord, I want to come to you and ask you for this because, Lord, you know, I really..." We start explaining to God as though the Lord somehow needs information from us. So our goal in prayer is not to inform him or explain to him. Jesus said he already knows what you need. All he wants you to do is ask. That's why the Lord's Prayer can be said in 25 seconds if you take your time. You're not informing him. You're praying to ask him to express dependence on prayer. And he doesn't need explanations. So the next point is brevity. Prayers can be brief and can be effective. And sometimes we think, "Well, I really don't have time." Really? You don't have 25 seconds to pray the Lord's Prayer? That's interesting. I think you're too busy. But of course, if we're going to get into our regular prayers beyond that, it should take some time. This is an unusual one, but the next one is ask. And I say this because I've had people say to me, "You know, I'm really uncomfortable asking God for things." That's exactly what you're supposed to do. In fact, in the original language, when it says ask and you shall receive, it's in the imperative, meaning it's a command. Jesus wants you, in fact, commands you to ask him for things. Why? He wants you dependent on him. He wants you to ask. Habit. Prayer is supposed to be a constant in our lives. Prayer is supposed to be a constant. You remember 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18? Rejoice, how much? Always. Pray, how? Without ceasing. That is what's called an iterative, meaning a bunch of little dots. It's to be a way of life. In everything, give thanks. Now, what we oftentimes do is forget the rest of the verse. For this is the will of God for you. God's will is that you rejoice always, pray without ceasing, everything give thanks. You can't live that way without faith. And that's what God wants from you. You're crazy if you're rejoicing in some situations unless you're a believer who believes God. Same with prayer. Same with giving thanks. All three are important. So that's supposed to be a way of life. And I'll tell you what, boy, it's been a long time coming for me, and I'm still in process, always going to be. But it's a way of life. Forgiveness. Do you know that when you don't forgive, God doesn't hear your prayers? Look at Matthew chapter 6. Here's one I don't like. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. Such an interesting concept. Most everybody in the room knows the Lord's Prayer, at least by and large. He gets done with the Lord's Prayer. Here's what he says in 6:14 of Matthew. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. So, you have an argument with your mom and dad, with a friend, your wife, your husband. Jesus said, you don't forgive them, I won't forgive you. Notice that in the Lord's Prayer, he says, forgive us our debts, our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. Father, please forgive me the way I forgive others. That's a fun prayer. And it's the only one of those six items that he repeats at the end of the Lord's Prayer. It's the only one that he repeats and says, you don't forgive, I'm not going to forgive, you're out of fellowship. This is fellowship forgiveness, not relationship forgiveness. Your relationship is secure in Christ. But your fellowship with God is broken. And so the Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord's not going to hear me. And so you've got to deal with sin to deal with God. And you've got to deal with sin with others to deal with God. And boy, there's times I don't like this at all. And this has very practical things, not only in those you know closely, but it affects all kinds of things in your life. Relationships at work, relationship on the road, all kinds of things about dealing with others. Because for a lot of us, we enjoy payback. I know I sure do. And that's a problem. So vengeance is an issue, and God wants to deal with that in our prayer life. Let's go on. Private. That's an interesting aspect of prayer. Prayer, giving, and fasting are not to be done to be seen by men. Why? He says, if you go in private and pray, and don't make it intentionally a public, well-known thing, I'm going to see in private, and I'm going to reward you openly. Because it takes faith to not make a big deal out of it. It takes faith to give quietly. It takes faith to fast quietly. He says you do it for his approval, not for the approval of others. Generosity. Love, love, love this one. Let's go look at Matthew 7. I've preached this before. I don't care. I like this so much. Matthew, he says this. Now, it's really unfortunate to me that some of the translations have added the idea of continuous, because that's not his point. In fact, I would say it's exactly the opposite. He is really saying, just ask, it'll be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock, and it will be open to you. Matthew 7:8, for everyone who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. Now he gives a story that illustrates that the idea is not that you have to keep doing it. Or what man is there among you who, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? We looked at a parallel passage in Luke recently on this. Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? And the answer is supposed to be very much so, very willingly. God wants to give you good things. Now, the struggle we all face is the no's and the wait. Now, I know you're looking at me and you're seeing how big this is. You're saying, well, and you're case, the nose is an issue, so is your weight. It's not what I mean. What I mean is, if God answers our prayers and he says no, or if he answers our prayers and doesn't answer it immediately, we think that something's out of whack. What would happen in your life if after every prayer you say, Father, thank you for the response you give to this? Because if it's no, it's for the best. If it's wait, it's for the best. But thank you, Father, that you always hear my prayers. That's a life of faith. And he says here, this isn't up for grabs. Jesus said, God wants to give you what is good. You're evil, you would give it to your kids. God loves you infinitely more than you love your children. That's how we're supposed to live our lives in prayer. But it doesn't stop there. we're important to God. Matthew 10 says, again, I'm an object lesson of the bad part of it. It says, Jesus said that the very hairs of your head are numbered. And you're looking at me thinking, how hard is that? But what he means is, God cares about the smallest details of your life. The very hairs of your head are numbered. Why give that illustration? Because Jesus is saying, I care about everything in your life. What would happen if you came to God today? You started to say, okay, new year, going to start out right. You said, Lord, I'm going to start praying. Start making a prayer list. And you begin, as I do, with the top of your sheet that says, God wants to give you good things, and God cares about everything. Because we think, well, I'm not going to pray about finding the car keys. He doesn't care about that. Sure he does. How big is your God? How much does he care? And if you prayed and said, Father, thank you, this matters to you. You know what you're doing? You're enlarging God. He deserves that praise. What Satan is about the business of doing is making God small in our minds. He wants us to think that he has massive cosmic powers. Little bitty God. He really can't answer our prayers. And what the Bible wants us to do is enlarge God, make him great and honor him for who he is. So that makes sense with Ephesians 3:14-21. His love, not only is his power limitless, the Bible says his understanding is infinite. So when we're praying, Father, I'm coming to you because of the wonderful things you do. When we're praying that way, we're making God small. And what God wants us to do is understand that not only is his understanding and power limitless, so is his love. So in Ephesians 3:14 and following, he says that he would pray that according to the riches of your glory, you would strengthen us with might through your spirit. Isn't that a great prayer every day? Strengthen us with might through your spirit in the inner person that Christ may have, and the Greek is a home in your heart through faith. And that you, having been rooted and grounded in Christ because of the love, may be able to understand with, oh, this is a great one, understand with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which is beyond understanding. That you may be filled to all the fullness with God. He said, I want you to dive into my Pacific Ocean of love. I want you to go into the middle of that ocean and dive in and realize you can't even begin to comprehend how much I love you. And so what do? We get mad because we can't find the car keys. Well, you don't love me. Really? Really? So a daily prayer, help us to understand that great love, Father, because if his love is without limit, his power is without limit, and he wants to give to us, our prayers change. But Satan is about the business of distorting the image of God in your life. Faith, the next one, Bible says, you know what else Satan is about doing? He wants you to believe God doesn't exist and that he's bad. He doesn't respond to you. What's Hebrews 11:6 say? Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe two things. Little rabbit ears. Two things. You believe that he is, that he exists, and that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. When you come to God, he responds to you. James says, if you draw near to God, what's he going to do? Draw near to you. You say, well, I've blown it. God doesn't want anything to do with me. That is a lie from hell. If you're willing to get right with God, man, you draw near to him, he'll charge draw near to you. He's not the one that moves, men and women. Again, Satan dishonoring God. The Bible says that our walk matters to prayer. Proverbs 15:8 says that the prayer of the upright is his delight. You ever thought about that? That when you're seeking to walk with God, it doesn't mean you never fail, but you're dealing with it, right? You confess and forsake. The Bible says you find mercy. The prayer of the upright is his delight. When you pray, you come to God and say, Father, I want to be more like you. Father, I pray for my child. I pray for my friend at work that he'll come to faith, that you'll open his eyes. Bible says he delights in you, that you give God joy. The prayer of the upright is, so our walk matters. Our walk matters the way we live. Again, not never failing, but dealing with our failures. Why don't we get answers? Well, there's two reasons the Bible talks about. James 4:2, do you remember that one? The Bible says, you can finish it for me if you want. You do not have because you what? You do not ask. So you say, why are my prayers being answered? You're not praying. You're not praying. And the Bible says you ask and don't receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasure. So when you're praying, you know, Lord, I've always wanted a vet, a really nice vet. Would you please give me that? But if it's a need, I remember driving one time down to see a friend, and he was a millionaire. And I said, Father, I've got a really small family. I don't have money. Would you provide a van? I wasn't necessarily thinking about the guy I was going to see. And I kid you not, I got down there, and he bought us a van, a pretty green van. Door opened all by itself, which at the time was a cool thing. You know, very generous man, but he loved to give. And God loves to give too. I don't want to imply to you, you know, a name it and claim it thing, that it's always good, every little thing you want. Self-centered prayers don't really get it done. Prayers for his glory do. Bible says God answers every prayer according to his will. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3 says his commandments aren't burdensome. That seems crazy. But the reason they're not is because later on in verses 14 and 15, after he talks about knowing you have eternal life, you can also know that he continues to respond to faith and says that whatever we ask according to his will, he hears us. And if we know he hears us, we know that we have the request which we've made to him. I have a question for you, a serious one. If you're asking God for something that he doesn't want for you, that he doesn't think is best for you, do you really want it anyway? That's going to ruin your life. I want it anyway. Well, we could throw a temper tantrum, but not the way to do it. I love Romans 8, 26 and 27. Look at the next one, and that is that there's a translation that goes on in your prayer life. Romans chapter 8, it's one of my favorites. This talks about what the Spirit does when a believer prays. Have you ever prayed about something and not known what to say? You've got a situation and, I don't know what to say. Maybe somebody is struggling, teetering on death. Is it better for them? Lord, I don't know what to pray here. Look at this. One of the coolest things in all the Word of God. Romans chapter 8 says, 26, likewise, the Spirit also helps on our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. Right, Paul. But the Spirit himself make intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Whoa, you know what he just said? When you come to God and you pray, he gets it. The Spirit says, Father, this is what he means. I've told, a lot of you have heard this story before, forgive me for the repetition, but my favorite illustration was I'm driving down 29 and it was really icy roads and people in the ditch left and right. And man, I'm driving down going, these crazy drivers, they don't know how to drive on ice. God said, really? So I come up over the hill on 29 and I get hit with a big gust of wind and my car starts doing this on Interstate 29. Coming down the mountain when I come and that wind hit and I started doing this, and I kid you not, in that car I said that I uttered this complex prayer, Lord, you know, I may have even gotten out help and he knew every detail of what I wanted. Got this one, Dan. God, the Spirit of God says to the Father, this is what they want, even if you don't get it right. Isn't that phenomenal? That's our God. Who is like our God? Who's personal like our God and understands like our God? Available? Hebrews 7:25 says he always lives to make intercession for him. The whole point of Hebrews 7 is kind of misunderstood. He says he's not part of the Aaronic priesthood. He's part of the Melchizedekian priesthood. And many people say, the Melchizedekian priesthood. But the point of that priesthood is you have a priest who lives 24/7, always awake, always available. And it says that he wants to save to the uttermost, completely, and the salvation there is to make you spiritually successful, those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for you. And when you're up at 3, he's there. When you're up at 6 a.m., he's there. When you're up at midnight, he's there. And he lives day and night and prays for you. Not only is the Spirit of God praying for you, but the Son of God is interceding for you to make you successful. That's our God. That's who we serve. And then confident, last one. The Bible says we are to approach God confidently. Don't you love it? You know that this is a passage that means a lot to me. Hebrews chapter 4, shall we? Man. The Bible, just no book like it. Nothing. Hebrews 4:14, seeing then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. You know what he's saying with this lead-in? We have an advocate who made it successfully. He died for us. He rose victorious. He rose into heaven. He's at the right hand of God. Hang in there, he's saying. Hang in there. We have someone that's there for us. Then he goes on and explains what he means. We do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. Double negative means we do have a high priest who does sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted, and we are, yet without sin. He made it successful. He knows how to win. He knows how to get there. He never failed. When we fail, we have a high priest that never failed and made it successful. Last verse. Let us therefore come how? What's it say? Boldly, confidently. That's how God wants you to come to him. Oh, but I blow it so much. Doesn't matter. Is Christ's blood adequate or not? Has he made you righteous or not? Has he sanctified you or not? The answer is yes. You're perfected before our God. So you come boldly to what kind of throne? A throne of grace. Aren't you glad? Why? Because when we come, we obtain mercy. When you come to God, you don't get what you deserve. Can I get an amen, Grace Bible Church? That's good stuff, isn't it? We don't get what we deserve. We receive mercy, and what do we find? What do we find when we get there? We find grace to help when? In time of need. Should you pray? You doggone right you should. I'm not sure what doggone right means, but you ought to do it. It's a big deal. You can come to a God who welcomes you into his presence, and you don't have to come slinking in and saying, I'm really nobody. He knows that, but he made you somebody in Jesus Christ. And so when he wants you to come in prayer, he wants you to come confidently. That's what the word means, confidently. And the throne that you arrive at isn't just a throne of the King of the universe. It's a throne of grace. And when you come, you don't get what you deserve. You get what you don't deserve, which is grace. That's our God. That's what prayer should be, and that's how you ought to get ready. Next week, we're going to look at some specific prayers that you might pray. But men and women, this world is falling apart. I heard someone talking on the news this morning. I'm sorry, I used the word news. But anyway, it was a television program, and they were talking about people like me. And they were talking about how horrible and dangerous that we were. And I thought, I don't feel horrible and dangerous. And I thought, my goodness, there is a grid that this world is looking at things with that just terrifies me at times. The polarization is increasing. And as it does, more and more, not less and less, we need to get on our knees. What if it was the will of God that there would be a small church in Bellevue, Nebraska that would unite together in prayer? If one man can change a nation like Elijah did, one church can change a nation, men and women. If this church, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. In the Old Testament, it was the nation of Israel being healed where God would hear from heaven. We can move the throne of God. We can move God. But he's looking for anybody that's willing to pray to come confidently and say, I don't have faith in me, but I have faith in what your son did for me. That's the kind of person that can come boldly. That's the kind of person that will get on their knees. That's the kind of person to say, I'll give you 5 more minutes a day. I'll give you 5 more minutes, Lord. 5 minutes to change my life. Maybe you'll give him 10. Maybe you'll do it twice a day. I don't know what you folks are going to do, but men and women, our children need it, our families need it, our country need it. Get on your knees and fight with me. Let's pray together. Father, I am the last person in the world that should be talking about things like this. There's no one I know that's more inadequate than I am. But for whatever reason, your grace was extended to me. And you saved me. You declared me righteous because of Jesus. May he receive glory for that. And I pray that you will set a passion in the hearts of people in this room. I pray that people will make that list, will get on their knees, and they'll battle together to change our nation. It doesn't matter to you whether we're considered great in the eyes of others. All that matters to you is that we're a people who are willing. And I pray that you'd give us the grace to get past ourselves and be willing for the sake of your son. In Christ's name, amen.
If you'd like to stand with us, let's worship.
You are the one that we pray.
Thanks, Hallie. You may be seated. Fun to watch the musicians up here leading us in that. We're going to be taking the cup now. When I was a young believer, one of the first persons I ever heard speak when I was just as I was becoming a Christian around that time was James Jose. He was pastoring Pleasant View, which was where a lot of people originally came from when I was a younger man. James asked if he could just say a quick word this morning. James, come on up. And then we're going to take the cup together.
One thing I've been praying about, and I told Darlene on our way here, I said, you know, it's cold. I said, you know, we got to take advantage of being old, because we could say, oh, it's cold, we're old, we can't get out. But we were coming. I said, the reason I come, I said, of course, I love the worship, but I know I'm going to be fed. I know I'm going to be fed, and I pray for him. And I'll tell you what, he fed me so much. Every Sunday, I think, it can't get any better than this, and it gets better and better. And if we keep praying, God's going to bring revival here. And you think, oh, we don't need revival. No, we do. We do. We need to get on our knees and pray. And I'm not a prayer warrior. And I did something this week in a store. I lost, as Joe Aldry said, I lost a piece. I gave somebody a piece of my mind I could ill afford to lose. I totally blew it. And it was terrible, and I was embarrassed and ashamed. Anyway, when he said, God gives us what we don't deserve, you know what? He not only gives us what we don't deserve, he gives us the opposite of what we deserve. I deserve to go straight to hell. I get to go to heaven. I deserve to be weak. He makes me strong. I deserve filthy righteousness, filthy rags as righteousness. He gives me perfect right. That has helped me so much when I pray, because he doesn't just give me what, if you know me, you know how I've fallen. I've fallen, but I fell into grace. I didn't fall from grace. I fell into grace. And God's given me the opposite of what I deserve. And if you knew my story, you'd know that. And you'll know it in my Sunday school class. But the one prayer promise that he showed me 2 years ago, and I tried it. Robert Morris said, test God. He says, test me in the area of money. We need some money here to get in the building and all that, and to send missionaries and all that. But I decided to test him with the verse in Corinthians where it says, I think there's 6 or 7 superlatives. You give, and God will see to it that always in every situation that you will have an abundance for every good deed. And I thought, okay, I'm going to do that. I gave more than my Social Security that year, giving more than what, that's all I had, Social Security and a little stipend from the church I taught Sunday school. I gave more than that, and I kept track of how much I gave and how much God gave me. I didn't give to get, but I gave knowing if you give, I'll see to it you always have plenty, not to hoard, plenty to give. And I gave more, God gave me more than what I gave. Now, I'm telling you, we need to believe God. The only joke I ever told God was when I my defrost wasn't working, and I said, God, could you just breathe out a little on my defrost? And then I said, told him a joke. I said, you know, he breathes out stars. And I said, and don't accidentally breathe out a star. He could blow my whole car up. And I think God laughed. But that's how big God is. He breathes out stars. That we need to, and Dan and I, we're not perfect. And I know some of you sometimes, oh, you have this high standard. He's not perfect and I'm not perfect. We fail. You keep your eyes on Jesus, but you edify and pray for this man, and we're going to see revival here. We need revival in our country. It is going down fast. And every day God has given me, almost every day, an opportunity to share my faith. And it's so easy. But God gives you the opposite of what you deserve. Remember that. Thanks, and this is a good brother to let me get up here, because he knows us preachers, we get long-winded, but thank you,
brother. I appreciate it. I love you, brother.
This was awesome today.
Thanks. Thank you. Can take that to Dave. Okay. Thank you. I didn't know what James was going to say, but we're going to take up an offering right now. And if the ushers would come forward. Well, thank you, James, for those kind words. Let's have a word of prayer, and let's honor the Lord by taking the cup. Our Father, we cannot ever thank you enough for what was done for us at the cross of Christ. I pray your Son will be honored in the manner in which we take this symbol. In Christ's name, amen. gentlemen.
If you want to stand with us, we have one more song before we close. One, two, three, four.
The greatest day.
Job, guys. Thank you. For those of you that are sitting, please remain sitting. For those of you that want to stand, please remain standing. But I really feel that the Lord deserves our humility. If you would, let's get on our knees as we close in prayer. For those of you that can. If you can't, feel free not to. Our Father, it's even awkward for us to do this around one another. And for me, it's because of pride. But you are worthy of praise. You are worthy of honor. And I pray that you will be in each of our lives today. I pray that as we come into this year, rather than being afraid of it, we might attack it by coming to the throne of grace. So please honor your son. In his name we ask it. Amen. I think I'm supposed to say something. Make sure you get signed up for the lunch and let's fellowship together next week. Stop by the information table. Have a great week and Happy New Year, all of you.